Hello, folks. Good to see you. I mean, first of all, I was just informed that we were running 1 minute and 12 seconds behind. And I think that speaks to, you know, the work from the Sana team. I'm incredibly proud of y'all. Thanks for putting this together. Also, thanks for all of you for joining us here. And also the speakers. I think we have two of the most sort of clever minds in AI with us here on stage. I think the flip side of that is that you can be incredibly nuanced. So we're going to start with a fire round of questions. And so I thought I'd start with the first. You can't be nuanced. You just do yes or no or a quick answer. And I thought we'd kick it off with, would you rather have Tom Cruise or ChatGPT run the world?
I think probably Tom Cruise, because at least he's a human. And it's very important that that we leave the more important aspects of human society in human hands, even humans I might dramatically disagree with.
So last week I asked ChatGPT, and he told me that I look much better than Tom Cruise, so I have to go with Chat.
Boaz is, to be clear, working on the safety and alignment of ChatGPT too, so you better trust it, otherwise we would all be a bit in a tough spot. Second question. So it's quite tricky to like define the morals of these systems. So what would you rather have, the sort of Harvard ethicists define the morals of these systems, or the first 1,000 numbers that come up in the Boston phone book?
Well, I'm not in the first 1,000 numbers, so probably I'll have the Harvard ethicists, but. I don't know how you feel about your colleagues.
I guess I have to disagree again. I think that AIs should not attempt to, overanalyze and try to kind of 4D chess their ethics. It's better if AIs follow clear rules and they try to basically be more like a jury of one peers, just to simulate the normal person or the reasonable person in the legal sense when they need to.
Isn't that what your Harvard ethicist colleagues are trying to do?
They're not that normal.
Okay. Short one stock, long one stock. Hmm? Short one stock and go long in one stock.
Oh. I think I can speculate on anything that might make market moves here. Short one stock. Yeah, I'll pass on this one. So, don't want to give away any important tips.
OpenAI is not a public company, yes, so Boaz, yes, I'm sure you could...
There's so much uncertainty, I will short and long it at the same time.
very, very good. Okay, so final question of the fire round. Who would you rather have controlling AGI? Demis, Elon, Zuck, or Sam?
Probably me. That would be a better outcome. I hope it doesn't come down to just one person controlling something that powerful. So I think this is something that should be in as many hands as possible.
Yeah, I think it's actually a lucky coincidence that we have good competition. And it's not the case that just one company is currently just controlling this. And I hope it stays. I hope that the more it's a tool that basically every user controls it rather than whoever created it.
Makes a lot of sense. And so, David, starting with you, we've heard a lot of claims today that superintelligence is less than a decade out. Mm-hmm. At that point, we will have sort of the intelligence of a Nobel Prize winner using all of our tools and so mm-hmm. on. You're applying this very concretely and specifically to nuclear fusion. Like, mm-hmm. what have you seen in terms of how these models can accelerate the scientific process, and specifically, how might it accelerate nuclear fusion?
Yeah, so great question. I mean, I think the exciting things there are not necessarily about replacing humans or doing things there, but doing things no humans could do. So on a nuclear fusion device, you have this incredibly hot plasma that you have to control. It's inherently unstable, and thousands of times a second you have to send control signals, And it's just not possible for any human being to do that. People have been trying for decades to come up with algorithms to stabilize these plasmas and control them. With artificial intelligence, you can tackle increasingly complicated, you know, combinations of control strategies that no human might come up with, just by running, you know, millions and millions of simulations of how one of these machines might work. So where I think this stuff has the most potential to really accelerate things is things where, you know, either you have abundant amounts of, you know, really good data, or really, really accurate simulators. And that's the sort of thing where you can sort of bootstrap from these simulations to get, you know, what you might call superhuman performance on things. Where the bottlenecks come in is precisely where you lack for that sort of thing, and you need some ways of closing a gap between simulation and reality. And that's where, you know, you start to interface with the real world again and all the messy complexity there. So I think the most promising areas for AI accelerating science come down to essentially wherever you have progressively more accurate either data or simulation.
Do you agree with the belief that these systems will have all human knowledge in their short-term memory at the same time? So it's as if, you know, you read every single paper, and then it should make sense that, you know, you would be able to draw analogies and come up with new knowledge just by a function of like mixing existing knowledge. Do you think that's true? And do you think we're seeing that? Or if not, when will we start seeing that type of advantage?
I can't speculate on when we'll start to kind of cross that threshold, even if people want me to. But what I've seen so far, the things that exist today certainly are very good at, you know, I find them useful for finding new keywords or, you know, areas of the literature I might have overlooked. I've certainly discovered things that I might not have otherwise known about, and so it can be very useful integrating just, you know, huge volumes of knowledge about, you know, the literature together. When I ask these systems to sort of speculate about new research areas, what I've seen so far tends to look more like you're kind of, you know, sort of taking keywords and kind of combining them together in a maybe kind of surface level kind of way. You know, it can be useful for sort of jogging ideas in the same way, just, you know, like rubber duck debugging can be. I haven't yet seen anything that really makes me think like, oh, that's like a totally, you know, totally unexpected idea. You know, we might get there soon, we might not. That's sort of my feeling of where things are for my own research practice at the moment.
Why do you think that's the case, Boaz? Do you think we went with the transformer architecture and like next token prediction? Do you think that's the wrong path if we want to develop systems that generate new knowledge, or will we just through scale, self-play, test, time compute eventually get to systems that are not just doing sort of keyword match, but actually generating new knowledge?
Yeah, I think there is no reason that we couldn't just get there by just continuing what we've been doing. If you look at the generations of models. So just speaking of, say, OpenAI models, you could maybe have compared GPT 3.5 to maybe, a middle schooler, and GPT-4 ranged between like a high schooler to a first maybe year undergrad. Now in the O series, you're starting to get like to models like that function more like a beginning and a graduate student. And typically that's around the threshold where you might have ideas for something novel, but not yet. But if we just extrapolate from this trend, I don't think we are far from models that will initially, you know, they're not going to have Nobel Prize insights, but they may well have really speed up science by being amazing research assistants and then later research collaborators and eventually also independent researchers.
And what do you think the cycle will be? Will we eventually get to like a self-improving system? If we look at how it's currently being rolled out, you basically have AI researchers using AI tools to do their AI research. So you're seeing some sort of acceleration as a function of that. Will we eventually get to an entirely self-improving system?
Yeah, it's an open question. I mean, I think we might. I think there's... sometimes I think about it, and it feels like we're trying to build a perpetual motion machine. It's like, you know, I think we're in a state a bit like with steam engines, you know, before the development of thermodynamics. We're building these things through experimentation and seeing how efficient we can make them. And you might say, you know, we were getting steam engines that were 50% efficient, 90% efficient, and, you know, maybe someone would say, oh, well, what if we could get something that's 110% efficient? Maybe, maybe not. You know, this is an empirical question at the moment. I think, you know, this analogy of, you know, a middle school level versus, you know, high school level versus college level, I tend not to like these kinds of metaphors because, you know, the AI that exists today, I prefer not to anthropomorphize it because in certain dimensions it's incredibly powerful, but in other ways still falls over and is quite brittle in ways that no human would ever really be brittle. So I think when it comes to sort of doing autonomous scientific research, we might end up in a situation where, you know, you spend as much time trying to figure out if the output is actually reasonable as you do actually sort of doing your own science. So I think it's, you know, it could go one of many different ways. It certainly will be, you know, certainly exciting to find out, you know.
And Boaz, you're spending a lot of time on alignment and safety currently. And we already, with the sort of current state of the models, struggle to understand them. Like, I always find, like, the mechanistic interpretability research, it's fun that people are doing it, but I also get a bit scared about, like, how simplistic it is and how little we know of what's going on inside these models. Will we ever be able to truly understand them? And is that necessary in order to assure that they're safe? Or how are you approaching this? Because the models are sort of scaling a few orders of magnitude more from here. So if we struggle now, what makes us confident that we'll be able to do that in the future?
Yeah, so let me answer the second question first. I think we don't need to fully understand them in order to have them align and follow instructions. We don't understand the human brain, but we have managed to have function in human society and human being ethical and human following instructions. And the second thing, I don't think that necessarily as models become more capable, they become harder to control. I think if we do our job right, we can actually have alignment techniques that will become better, so the models will be hopefully both more instruction following and more honest, less hallucination as they become more powerful. But we have a work cut out for us to get there.
And when you're thinking about the scenarios of where this could go wrong, you know, we've been talking about it before, you sort of see this four scenarios, like where do you see this going?
So I think this is a very important time period right now over the next, say, 5 years or 10 years, where there are both technical challenges on how we control these systems and how we get them to be honest, to follow instructions, and also social challenges. What are we going to use them for? Are we going to use them to cure cancer? Are we going to use them to create new sources of energy? Or are we going to use them to just automate away all jobs, or even worse, use them to have like a surveillance state?
It sounds better with the new energy and curing cancer.
Yes. So I hope that's on it.
Me too.
but usually we look at this in sort of four quite like simplistic terms. The truth is probably more nuanced. Like, what do you think about for example, Russia or China? They must be in a position now where, like, if other countries get super intelligence ahead of them, they'll be in a tough spot. Do you think we'll see efforts there be accelerated too? And how are you thinking about that at OpenAI?
I mean, I don't know about, you know, I'm not doing policy at OpenAI, so just me speak just for myself. For myself, I think, you know, we have this technology that could really elevate the standards of life, the abundance, prosperity, deliver education, deliver healthcare to all of the planet. So I don't think we are really, I mean, we shouldn't be seeing it as just saying, okay, but this is important for us to get it and for China not to get it. I would love for everyone to get the benefits of that, including the Chinese people, the Russian people, and all of them. And I hope that their governments will see it the same way too.
Yeah, I can't disagree with that. You know, we're supposed to be arguing here, I suppose. But yeah, no, I mean, again, also don't work on the policy side, also just my own opinion. But I feel like there's sort of two different ways of approaching AI progress. And, you know, do we treat AI as a normal technology, as some people said, or as this sort of thing that could be this, you know, geopolitical sort of superpower that would be so powerful that it has to be kept secret? And you look at the way that, you know, some geopolitical players are treating this, and if there are countries where research groups are releasing this openly, it suggests to me that they're not thinking of this as the sort of thing where, you know, if one country controls this, then they dominate the future. They're thinking of it more like, more like conventional information technology, where it can be very powerful and can be very transformative, but also the sort of thing that, you know, should be spread to as many hands as possible and should be under broad control. So I would certainly like to see that world more.
Okay, two quick questions to wrap us up. First, what is one thing that you think is sort of commonly agreed on in the industry that you strongly disagree with?
It's hard to say what's commonly agreed on in the industry. I mean, I think there's what's commonly agreed on in my Twitter feed. So I guess I maybe disagree that, when we talk about, you know, timelines to superintelligence, I think if you're talking, you know, truly superintelligent, you know, across all sort of human aspects, I don't know that we're ever going to see that. I think that it would be like talking about an airplane that's, you know, super bird in all respects. I think that as this technology matures, we'll double down on the things that work well, and there'll be certain things about, you know, humans that, you know, in some sense aren't worth replicating, and it'll just kind of turn into something different.
Boaz?
So I think, yeah, like, I don't know if there's consensus in the industry, but when I talk to people that are very optimistic in seeing, you know, the world transform in a few years, I think they are underestimating the friction in getting the technology from the lab to actual really wide deployment. And when I talk to people that maybe, like, you are a little bit more pessimistic on the long term, I think they are underestimating how transformative AI will be eventually.
Fantastic. We're actually running up on time. You were a bit shy on stage, but I heard you behind on the long, short question. You said the long sauna, short glean. So that's the message I want to leave you all with. Very good. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you, David and Boaz.
Thank you.